Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition with one of the new faces in WrestleZone. So previously we've had Evan Young, and just debuting about the show afterwards is my guest, is Ronan King. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
So I'm looking forward to this one because, I know I've told you twice, but it's the first time I was telling the viewers and listeners. I was going to get you on quite near the start, but I wanted to actually see you wrestle before I did. And I did at Halloween, and it wasn't Halloween Hijinks. It was Summer Hill Showdown. But we'll get onto that in a little bit because something happened to that show that I think everyone's wanting to know about that New Year coming on, because I did get a couple questions from your fellow wrestlers at WrestleZone about it. The first question is always the same when we're getting a new guest on. It's the most cliche question in podcasting history for wrestlers. What got you into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that got you hooked on pro wrestling?
See, mine's quite funny because I did not get into pro wrestling until quite later in my life. So like, as a kid, I'd always seen bits and bobs. I knew the main guys, John Cena, Randy Orton, you know. I love them, but it was my younger brother that got quite into it. And my grandpa bought his WWE 2K15, so that shows you quite how late it was. I know it's now playing it back, not a great game, but at the time, loved it. So that was really my first proper wrestling experience was WWE 2K15, but I wasn't even watching WWE. I was just kind of playing it because it was fun to play. And then I'd say December, maybe November 2015, and I was sitting in my mom's office, you know, just waiting to go home. I was bored. I was going on YouTube and I was like, oh, I wonder what WWE's up to nowadays. And I think the first storyline I came introduced to was Roman Reigns versus the Authority, that kind of Vince McMahon, Sheamus stuff. So that was really what got me hooked. And from there, I started to watch it a lot.
That seems to be quite a common thing I'm finding with like the younger wrestlers that make me feel incredibly old every time I speak to them. But video games seems to be the way. I mean, people my age, it's usually Channel 4 when they ran pay-per-views, which I'm going to guess was maybe just before you were even born, will have been before you were born, that happened. So that was like 2000. But video games seems to be the other way that people get into it. And would have been the first time it was on PS3, wasn't it? That was PS4.
Well, no, I don't Xbox 360, but I know it went on to PS4 and Xbox One, but I don't my Xbox 360. So, yeah.
I remember, I had it for the PS3 before I got a PS4, and seeing it was like, oh, it's the same kind of game as last year. Cool, this is ace. But then I got on PS4, and I'm going to guess if you got an Xbox One. And then seeing the graphics, I was like, oh my God, this is the most realest thing ever.
It was such a change. It was such a change. I remember because I think I didn't upgrade to the next console till 2K16, but I remember seeing it, comparing it to my Xbox One and my Xbox 360. I was like, wow, like that's amazing.
And then it went all downhill from 2019 onwards. Hopefully, I mean, by the time this comes out, 2K22 is going to be out. So, you know, fingers crossed.
Oh. We have hope.
We can only hope. Depending on, I don't know who's going to be on it because they got rid of everyone. So, but no, we're still going to buy it, even though people say that they don't watch it anymore. Like, you know, you still keep it in mind somewhere. So yeah, your first favorites, you said it was your classics, your John Cena, your Randy Orton through the video game, and then was it Roman Reigns after seeing the Authority stuff?
Yeah, so I really liked Roman Reigns for a while. I got really into AJ Styles. I don't know, it's just out of frame, but I've got my AJ Styles flag up there. So I really got into AJ when he joined, and I went back and watched stuff. So I became really into Seth Rollins as well, who I'm still a massive fan of to this day.
That's quite cool. That's quite cool seeing the crossover because, of course, AJ Styles came in 2016 Royal Rumble.
2016. Yeah.
So, I mean, in my mind, then you wouldn't even know who he was until he made his debut.
Never really seen him.
So that goes to show how like from a brand new fan taken to him fairly straight away just shows how good AJ Styles is. And I do remember the only reason I went to like the first WWE show in years in Aberdeen was because it was AJ Styles and Dean Ambrose in the main event. Like, I have to.
I was there, and it was just, I remember it being amazing.
Oh, like, yeah. It was worth going to, absolutely. Just for that alone. My only downside to it was your first. I went to get a refreshment or something like that, and I thought, oh, I better rush back to my seat after the interval, and it was Mojo Rawley. The music hit. It was the Hype Bros, and I was like, I could have just dawdled a little bit. I would have been fine. So wrestling itself, then. So you got into it. I wouldn't even say it's quite late on for you. It's probably right age. Just sounds late on for us old farts that are watching it for so long.
I missed the phase where it was cool. I'll say that. Of course, going through school, there was that phase where everyone's like, "Oh, wrestling's the coolest thing ever." I wasn't watching anything. I'd see like John Cena, Randy Orton, of course, but that's because everyone saw it. But I wouldn't keep up with it. But then when, you know, nobody was really speaking about it anymore, that's by chance where I started to really enjoy it, which was annoying. But
yeah, wrestling is, even now, I think it's still a little bit of a dirty little secret. It's like you can't like it. Everyone's, all the real lads are watching UFC, which is just as fake. Just as fake nowadays. So how so were you introduced to like the local scene through like just a random poster somewhere? You end up going to WrestleZone, or were you aware of things like ISW? What was your kind of experience there?
So I like heard of local wrestling. I knew it was a thing, but I never went, I don't think. I went to the WWE shows, but I never been to WrestleZone. It was more after that 2016 show, I went to my mom. I was like, I want to be a wrestler. Like, it was simple as, you know, I want to be a wrestler now. So I started looking into it. I don't think I was old enough at that point, so it took a few years. But then I, looking around, found WrestleZone, found they were doing youth class. I was like, all right, sign me up. That sounds awesome.
So did you do anything like, cause I know a lot of people do a little bit of a martial art or something. It's like as close as you can get to doing wrestling. What was your kind of background there?
So I did Muay Thai for a little bit, which is like kickboxing even. And then I did a bit of jiu-jitsu as well for a little while. And it was just kind of like, that's the closest I'll get, you know, like stepping in a boxing ring at that point was the closest I get to be in a wrestling ring. So that was the coolest thing ever for me. So did a bit of that.
So did you do any like backyard wrestling, trampoline kind of stuff, or were you getting to the don't try this at home?
Oh no, me and my little brother all the time, you know, we were trying, you know, we get on the trampoline, we'd, you know, be our favorite wrestlers. I remember we went over to my mate's once and we broke his trampoline because I speared him through it and he went through the net, and it was just a whole scene. But those were the days. They were so much fun.
What was your gimmick then? Or were you just purely someone else, another wrestler?
I was mainly just always AJ or Seth. But I remember those were the two that I was always like, oh, I won't be them too. So I just steal their gimmicks completely and just do their act.
Yeah, back in my youth, I was Jeff Hardy because I would climb on stuff. That was pretty much the reason I was. I mean, Jeff Hardy is my favorite anyway, but because me and my mate, I was the only one that would climb on stuff. I was Jeff forever.
Yeah, well, I mean, they're worse people to be.
Exactly. I mean, definitely in a wrestling standpoint, certainly. So you say you didn't really go to wrestling until you found out they did youth classes, and that was
no.
That was it. So
I'd seen posters, but I never ended up going or anything like that.
So when did you? What year was it? Say 20? Was it 2017, 2018? You finally signed up? No.
So I accidentally said this to Alex Webb. I remember at Summer Hill when we were speaking, but I remember just walking away going, "Wait, that's a lie." I knew I'd been training for 3 years, but it hadn't hit me. So I said 2017, but it was actually 2019 I started. It's like first class of 2019 I started.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it is easy to forget that 18 months / 2 years are kind of
exactly
gone. So 3 years. And so 2019, I'm trying to remember who the big name was. Like, oh, it was Pac, because it was last.
Yeah.
This was I just did a whole thing on my site today, putting all the results in on a page, and of course that was the last one. So 2019. So you wouldn't even probably known that you wouldn't have went to that first class. So you probably would have went seen were you part of a youth class with PAC? Was that something that happened?
No. I never got to see PAC. Sadly, I wish I did, but no, never got to. I got to go to the show though, and he's just on another level. He's insane.
Oh yeah, it was weird meeting him because you expect him to be so like annoyed because that's what his character is, and then he's like all happy joking away with you, and then you get the picture and you see the picture and he's just sullen. So
he's got the dead face on. Yeah.
it's quite incredible to watch. So youth training then, I don't know how that goes. What was it like for your first couple of sessions then? Was it just cardio, grappling? What was it like?
So I'm trying to think. So I remember, I met Evan there. So that was one of the first people, like, there was three of us when I first started. It was me, Evan, another guy. And we, at this point, the training academy, have you ever been to the training academy?
I unfortunately have not, no.
Okay, right. Well, it's different now, but there used to be a wall in between the ring room and this other area, which was the mat room, which just got mats. So I was in the mat room for a good few weeks. Us three were just in the mat room for a good few weeks. So, you know, learning how to bump onto a mat, luckily, we never had to just flat back it. Learning how to grapple was a big one. Do a bit of chain. Rolls are a massive thing. Just stuff like that. Like very basic strikes, kind of light strikes. Like no one would ever actually do them properly, but yeah, that sort of thing. And then we eventually got into the ring, which was nice.
So I'm guessing it's a little bit different than a boxing ring when it comes to it. It's just from looking at it, I wouldn't know from, I've been in a boxing ring, I've been in a wrestling ring, but I've just been standing, which is the way I'll prefer to be in the future. But yeah, so getting into the ring for the first time, how did that feel?
I can't even describe it. Like, it just felt unreal to me because it was something I was so passionate about that it was just, like, it felt like, you're no way nearly made it, but at that point I felt like I'd made it in life. I was like standing in the wrestling ring about to do a drill inside the wrestling ring. It was just the coolest thing ever to me.
I've spoken to other guys in the past, and it sounds like the classes, like, it weeds out the weak quite quickly. I don't know if it's just because it's so intense or people don't realize that they've got to actually do some work to get where they need to be and get into the ring. So it's just you and Evan that made it through. Were you kind of fast-tracked into a more advanced class quickly so you could kind of catch up, or was it just yourselves quite regularly?
So, we first started, we started going in with, like, the other class. Trying to think of people who would be in that. Like, Bradley was in it, I remember. And we'd be in with those guys, and like we'd be nowhere on their level at that point, but they were lovely to us, and they like try to keep us up and like keep us right. So that was it for a little while, and then I got really badly concussed for ages. So I got really unlucky because I'd say October, I play rugby as well. So I hit my head, and I think it was just like a combination of just like multiple head hits from both wrestling and rugby, just completely wiped my brain, and I was out for a good few months because I had to get like brain scans and stuff. It was all crazy to me. I had to relearn how to balance. It was mental. And then the week that I get medically cleared and I go back to training, I get one training session, and then COVID hits. So
yeah, all that time trying to get back to where you wanted to be, gone in almost an instant because of COVID. That damn COVID. So when it came to things like, obviously you did a bit of jiu-jitsu and Muay Thai and stuff like that, so the bumps and that weren't, obviously they're not going to be the nicest things in the world, but you were kind of, your body was kind of prepared for hard hits quite quickly.
Yeah, so I'm very thankful that I did stuff like that, because I can't imagine, because I know how much bumping hurt for the first time. I think that's quite a good way to weed out people of wrestling, is because you know, everyone thinks it's fake and the ring's like a trampoline. I can promise you it's not. It does hurt. So
I remember seeing a ring getting built and just like all this metal and then all this wood. I'm like, geez, and they have this like tiny thinnest foam underneath the canvas. I'm like, that's doing nothing.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, it's like, I'd rather have it than not, but it's not the most pleasant thing on thing. Definitely not. So I'm very thankful that my body was almost used to high impact kind of sports that I could deal with it.
So with the concussion stuff, was that just were you just told just get yourself cleared before you come back? Were they quite good with just like, no, you come back when you can. Even though you may have been champing at the bit to start all over again, were they just like pushing you back?
Yeah, so it was a whole like, my mum as well was very like, you are not going back until we know for a fact you're ready to go back, because it would give me the whole like, you cannot take another hit to the head, whatever, and wrestling is quite a high chance at points you're going to take hits to the head. Mm-hmm. So of course I went and watched a lot. I remember that I kept going and like picking up on little things, but you know, the whole time I was dying to get back. So I just remember that being hard, but it was annoying to sit and watch, but it was better to sit and watch rather than to just not be around that atmosphere, because being around it gave me hope of coming back. So they were very much though like, yeah, you have to be ready to come back because we can't mess you up.
Or your mom's going to come down and cause a storm as well. She's not drugged if she doesn't let you. But that shows your passion anyway. So you were still going even though you couldn't actually do it. And like you said, what was it like getting into that first session, even though the world ended the week after? What was it like getting into that first session? Did you feel like you'd lost a lot of time or lost a lot of what you remembered, or did you kind of pick it up after a couple of times?
I felt completely a fish out of water. Like, because of course, me and like Evan were at the same level, and the other guy that was still with us at this point, we were at the same level when I went out. We'd all been training set. And he came back and Evan was debuting on shows and Evan was like really comfortable. And I completely was like, how do I bump again? Like all that sort of stuff. So I felt completely a fish out of water, but I still wanted to do it.
And again, that just goes down to your passion. So COVID hit. Of course, this is the long running thing on this podcast, because you know you can't escape it. That we had 18 months or so out of just doing nothing. Because you had one session in, I'm assuming you'd be gutted that at that point we didn't know how long it was going to be. But how did you keep yourself occupied? And were you doing like online sessions? How are you keeping your mind going wrestling wise?
I don't think I ever actually went to any online sessions, because I didn't feel like I knew anyone too well. And like, I'm sure if I went, of course, 100%, they would have all been like lovely and greeting, but I didn't feel like I knew anyone too well enough that I hadn't been around enough to like know what they'd be speaking about half the time. So I would just like, you know, sit and watch my own little wrestling. I would watch back old stuff that I'd never seen, all that sort of stuff. I can't really remember how much like watching. I just remember watching a lot because there was nothing really else to do. I'm playing the games a lot. But 2K19, not 20 as much.
Yeah, I mean, I'm one of those. I was one of those idiots that got rid of 2K19 to get 2K20. That's just what I do most years. And I made a mistake. I definitely made a mistake that way. So what do you remember watching it? So you go back old school stuff. Was it just stuff on the network? Was it old AJ Styles stuff on like the TNA app? What was your go-to?
So I was still a very big, like, I didn't know too much about other promotions. I watched a little bit in New Japan, but not as much as to say I was familiar with it or anything. Didn't really watch any TNA or anything. Watched a little bit AEW. Like, I wouldn't say I was a fan. Like, now I'm a massive fan. I get to that later, but I would say I wasn't. I just watched the stuff that everyone was talking about and building buzz about. But I'd go back and watch a lot of Michaels. I think I rewatched one time like the whole Seth Authority 2015 run with the belt. I just loved that. era of Seth Rollins, Bret Hart, stuff like that. Just some old classics that I knew I should have watched before, but I never had.
That seems a bit wild that you would have watched the Seth Rollins Authority run and like randomly an old dude with face paint would turn up and it's Sting and everyone's treating him like a legend and you're just watching it going, I think I've heard of the name Sting.
Yeah, he was that guy in 2K15 that was the bonus. That's all I mean.
Oh man, there's a lot of people listening to this and watching this going, oh my god, how is this happened? But no, much like when we spoke to Evan, Evan of course is young as well, but he seems to have this kind of, I don't know if he's picked up too many tips from Chris Archer or that, but he seems to have this kind of old soul about him. Like yeah. He likes all this kind of older stuff, and then now I'm speaking to yourself and it's like 2K15. I'm like, what happened in 2K15? What happened in 2015? I only remember stuff from like pre-2005 sometimes. I know, that's just showing my age when it comes to this.
I wouldn't know anything or barely anything from before then.
So you're keeping up, kind of keeping up to date with the wrestling now and back in time. So, I mean, we came to training, of course. Were you into the one-on-ones when you could do it, or were you kind of waiting for the group stuff?
Honestly, when we did non-contact, I was in all the time. So that was quite fun. Another one that was annoying was actually the first week they started doing non-contact, I broke my wrist. So I had to miss I had 2 weeks until I could do it again. So that was really annoying. But I was in non-contact. I was in a group with Evan himself. Archer and Bill were my original four little group. So we just kind of go in and, you know, just get moving around the ring. And it was a lot of fun, but it was really annoying because I hadn't built up the match knowledge, I'd say, yet. So when, Bill William Sterling, he'd say like, I'll have a match against Invisible Man, I would just completely be lost because I'd forgotten all like the theory behind wrestling, almost, not just the physical stuff. I'd say that was the bit I always struggled with, was the theory rather than the physical aspects of it.
Yeah, you're in two minds whether you want to try and do all this grappling and rolls and that, and on the other hand, you're like, well, if I kick him in the head, that's the match over. There you go.
Yeah.
Next. Okay. So, yeah, that non-contact, did you find that was kind of a really good way to learn that theory quickly, was figuring out where you need to be, where your body had to be positioned in certain moments of the match? Or was that something that you preferred just having someone else there to kind of bounce off of?
Like, of course, it's way better with someone else there and you can like work off each other and all that. It's great. But I guess from being in the ring, I could start to pick up stuff that like Scotty Swift had taught me before. And I started to get it, I'd say. I think the thing is, for me, I think most of the guys would all say this, is COVID somehow made me a better wrestler. I don't know how it's worked, but I have a few theories on why. But
you gotta find some positives in this whole thing somewhere, certainly when the shows came back, noticed. Just, I mean, of course, you have already heard Kyle and Kaylee noticed your tremendous shape, but we'll get onto that in a bit. But so you did notice the difference in a lot of wrestlers when they came back. Either their in ring work was just infinitely smoother, maybe some were a bit rougher because it's the first time in a while they've had a crowd to work with. But you noticed the differences, especially, well, certainly I did as a big old nerd for WrestleZone. I noticed these things, even if some folk were just happy just to see wrestling again. So when that first show was announced, of course, Halloween Hijinks was coming back. You weren't on the show. Was that just a case of you didn't feel you were ready, or you wanted to get a little bit more contact training before they thought you'd be ready to get back in the ring?
Well, yeah, I was never asked, really. So I can't complain about it or anything. But I remember at that point, so I'd say halfway through COVID, when we had to cut off training again for that like second lockdown in December 2020, would have been. Yeah. When I came back in January, I'd completely branched into it, a little indie fanboy. So you know, one of my mates came over and, you know, we couldn't go in each other's house. So I had my garage and we had the door open because it was allowed in COVID rules. I would sit on like my garden bench with a TV up and he'd introduced me to Impact because he said Kenny Omega was on it. And I loved Kenny Omega at that point. So I started watching that. I went into AEW. I started watching all this like more independent stuff. I won't say it gave me a lot more passion for wrestling, I guess. Because at that point, WWE had kind of windered and I wasn't enjoying it as much. It was just not for me anymore. Whereas all this new stuff was just super exciting. And I was loving it. And I still love it to this day. It's the stuff I still watch. So that really just, I picked up more when watching that. So when I came back, I felt I was way ahead of where I was leaving. And I got better without contact. So that when contact was allowed and we were doing all this stuff again, I could actually start to like put together little competent matches and stuff. And it was just a constant grind of just coming in. We get told, oh yeah, just have like a fun little match. We do the fun little match. I felt so much better for it. And of course, Halloween was announced. I wasn't on the card, but I wasn't expecting to be on the card because I'd never been on shows before, anything like that. So it was a real actual shock to me when I got told I was going on the Academy show. Is that?
Of course, the Academy show, which I didn't write down because I'm terrible at my preparation. So yeah, you find watching this more creatively free kind of show, yeah, give you a little bit more of ideas and sequences. And I mean, because I mean, I'm still a big WWE fan. I won't deny it. But yeah, I can see why people. I only watch the pay-per-views, so I don't get bogged down in the weekly, and I don't see the same thing over and over again because I'm just watching it once a month. Really, I catch up on YouTube. That's about it. But yeah, so I can see why people go, this is a bit more set in stone the way things work and how the structures are. I mean, obviously they make a lot of money, so it eventually, you're young enough, eventually you may be there and that'll be what you're doing. But you're going to be making some money because of it. But AEW and Impact, yeah, you're a bit more, it's a bit more creatively free to try stuff a little bit more, and you're picking up bits and pieces there. I'm gonna, even though you will be able to tell me, I'm the host, so should be able to actually to say what your first match was, because I wrote it down as Christmas Chaos and that was incorrect. So while I'm doing that, I will try and not look like I do just look like I'm Googling. So hang on. Go on to swnscotland.com and you can find all the results for every show from WrestleZone and all that, because I record everything in writing. Right. God, we've put out too much stuff about WrestleZone.
There's a lot. No, I love it. I read through all the articles and stuff constantly. So.
Right. Christmas. There we go. Live from the Training Academy 2. Right. Okay. First match. Mr. P. Excellent. Right. Okay. So you had your first match November 6th, you know, because I'm a professional, I have all this information. The WrestleZone Training Academy. So at least it's a comfortable environment. I'm guessing a lot of the people that would have went to that show are your more regular crowd / friends and family kind of thing. So a bit more of a comfortable audience. So yeah, what was it like getting, you know, told you're getting your first match and how was it?
So I can stop smiling. So I kind of got like a little nudge because after one training, I just got told, get yourself a pair of boots. As I'm walking out with Evan, he goes, that was my call. So just get ready. So of course I get told after a training match, they're like, yeah, we'd love you to do it. Couldn't stop smiling. I just felt amazed, but I didn't know who I was working yet. I got told I was working on Halloween hijinks. Yeah, because I was staffing for that show, and just after the show, Mr. P came up to me and was like, oh, we're working at the Academy. So that was great. I couldn't really have asked for a better first match in the sense of, I mean, he makes everything make sense. And I understood why we did everything in that match. So that was really ace to me. Yeah.
Like, especially with Mr. P anyway, because he's got like a teaching background, he knows how to break down stuff quite logically. And of course, he's got a little bit of an old school mentality because he started watching, what, late 80s. So he knows how the wrestling zone style is. In fact, he's wrestled there for, must be 7 years now-ish, like that. I think around would have started about, okay, about 2014, 15, something like that. He was in ring regularly. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. That's a guy that you want to get in the ring with straight away. And the fact that his character's so larger in life, you don't have that much pressure to be the bad guy because you don't have to do an awful lot to be the bad guy.
Yeah. So, actually, yeah, I remember going back to the 80s stuff, we stole a spot in that match from Mr. Perfect and Rowdy Roddy Piper, and that was something I was like, I've seen like their stuff, but I've never seen matches like that. So that was a cool spot to do and a little nod back. And again, with the whole, like, his character, he's so over. And he brings out a presence to the ring that made it easy for me almost to get heat off him.
Yeah, again, that doesn't surprise me. Did you always send you homework, like going, right, watch this match, watch this spot, watch this bit, and we're going to kind of do it? Yeah, that sounds like Mr. Peel. I love the guy. But yeah, he's definitely got teacher vibe off him because he is a teacher, of course. So that first thought, you come out as the bad guy, the heel for people who know the lingo. When you were putting that character together, the kind of cocky bad guy, How much input did you put into it? Was there anyone that you kind of tried to pattern off of?
There's so much. Like all my life, I've always loved the heels. I don't know why. It's always been a thing. Like, I think it was when AJ turned heel in 2016. That's my favorite like run of him by miles in WWE sense, was that heel 2016. So I'd say I stole a lot of that. A lot of Young Bucks went into it because I was watching them a lot of the time. I caught a lot of that, like, that's when they just turned heel and they were just that cocky, like, charisma kind of guys. It was all Adam Cole as well. I'm a massive, massive Adam Cole fan. And it's a lot of that sort of thing. I think you can see it a lot. Those are the guys I kind of take off as well. It's like Shawn Michaels, Seth Rollins. Like, when they're being heels, that's the sort of stuff I really enjoy. So I start to take some stuff from it.
We do have some questions about your attire from numerous places. We'll just start with is it Barry McLeod?
Barry.
Okay,
that would be my mum.
Okay, so your mum asks, where do you get your clothes?
Oh, she'll want to hear this one because she knows she'll be mentioned. So,
no daft, well, your mum. She's no daft.
Super tights are for your gear, and it just came to the point where I was like, this is no way going to be ready for the show. So I was like, I need to find something that's out there, something that's going to give me that like little bit of attention, whatever. What would I hate to see someone wear? What if I looked at someone and be like, oh, I don't like you if you're wearing that? I was just looking through, not going to lie, looking through women's clothing websites, and I found them. I was like, that's it. That's what I'm going with. So that's where they come from. The glasses, I thought originally, I bought them back in like summer. I thought they were cool, and I got them. I was like, they're not cool. They look dumb. So I was like, well, I was just looking through stuff. I was like, that's perfect. This t-shirt, which I wore out to Christmas Chaos, but that was the one time, is just I go to like a quite like closed off gym, and we're all really good mates there. I'm really good mates with the owner because he used to be my old rugby coach. So just as like a token of support, they made me a little Ronan King t-shirt for the match. And then the jacket that I come out to now, that is stolen completely straight from my mum's wardrobe.
I think we may have mentioned it in our review podcast, but yeah, I did have a vibe that it was not yours. I will like to apologize to your mum because I did call it his granny's coat. So I'm sorry. I'm sorry. <for that. laughs> Adam Morrison, who writes for us, he's also asked about the zebra print tights, and please explain yourself. So pretty much you picked out everything that you would hate. So you thought,
yeah,
hate you because of it.
Gives me like that little like flashy, like, oh, what's this guy wearing? Kind of
like the old like Magaluf holiday boy kind of,
yeah, exactly,
kind of vibe. Yeah, that's pretty much, yeah, that's what I got from Summerhill Showdown as soon as you came out. The jacket, for one. But the, everything else was like, God, I hate this guy. I just hate this guy.
Yeah, exactly.
So it did its job perfectly.
What I really like about the jacket as well is the reason I went for it was, of course, I come out and I love doing the double bicep. So I saw the jacket and no sleeves. I was like, this is perfect. This is what I need right now.
So you had your first match, Mr. P. Great, again. When were you told about Christmas Chaos thing? Because this is one of WrestleZone's like marquee shows. They've got like their seven biggest shows of the year. And even though this is only their second big show, third overall for 2021, was like getting told you were going against Evan Young at Christmas Chaos.
So that's a really funny one, because I wasn't told until a week before, because of course it was originally billed as William Sterling, Evan Young. I don't know if that ever made it out, but I know there's like a few articles around, because that was originally the plan. But you know, it's wrestling, stuff happens all the time. So I remember I just got a text as I was heading home from school one day, just being like, are you free for the Christmas show? I thought it was just, are you free to do staffing, which I want to do anyway. So I was like, yeah, of course. And then he said, okay, cool. We want you and Evan on the VIP show doing the Training Academy showcase. That felt amazing. I remember being over the moon because that was a big show. I knew there was quite a big crowd for it, and I really was just excited to do it. So, of course, I was instantly texting my mom, texting a few of my mates, being like, by the way, I'm wrestling if you want to come watch. So of course it was also terrifying, because with the Mr. P match, which I had a good month or something to kind of sort myself out for it. However, I did have COVID right until I got out 2 days before the show.
You have like the worst luck in finding.
I do actually. But so I had COVID, so that was, but that also, during COVID, I was stuck in this little room, but I kept myself fit, and I just kept myself watching wrestling and getting cool ideas for stuff. But so I had just so long with that match that, like, with me and Evan, if it wasn't Evan, I think I would have just completely have panicked and just not knowing what to do myself. But having that whole, like, been training with him for so long, knowing each other's movesets, knowing each other's like strengths, I feel like we really built a good match out of everything that we knew.
Especially in a venue like Danston, which seems to be kind of maybe the third home of WrestleZone, because you've got the Northern, and then you've got the Leisure Centre. No, I'd probably say second home then, because Leisure Centre maybe third overall. But so one of the regular haunts where people get to. And I don't know, unbeknownst at the time, you knew that. We'll give them a shout out again. Kyle and Kaylee were going to be traveling up from Glasgow to see it, and they did a podcast about the show. Was that one you listened to thinking, oh God, like, what are they going to think about me? Because these guys have seen wrestling all over the country now, and Kaylee is quite strong opinionated, so it could have went one way or another. So when you hear the feedback from not just your peers, but from fans, what was it like listening to that back?
Oh, I remember I was so nervous. When it like came out, I was like, oh no, what if they hate me? What if they think I can't wrestle? But I was just, when hearing it was all positive stuff. And I remember that just pushed me to another level of, I just want to get better and better, because like hearing people are enjoying your stuff really kind of makes it feel worthwhile and makes it feel like you're doing something right, I guess.
Yeah, when I listened back, it seemed to just be glowing. I was like, right, I'm gonna have to get to this next show now. I've been cancelled, but I'm gonna have to get to Summerhill Showdown to see what the fuss is about.
No, I remember that just completely just that made my like week entirely. I was just like, I remember the Tremendous Shape one was one I felt great about, because I remember when I'm coming back into coming back into non-contact training and gyms were opening, that's when I kind of got the drive of, this is something I'm really serious about. This is something I really want to pursue. So I remember I'd run to the gym every morning at 5 a.m., you know, do a workout before school and go home, or like play rugby after school. It felt like it all paid off. Like everything had paid off when I got to hear that people were enjoying it and really enjoying the character and stuff.
And then that obviously would also help with the character, because, you know, you got a lot of ego boost and people with your glowing reviews of your work. So that leads us to Summer Hill Showdown, which I finally got to see you to wrestle. And this is where everyone's going to be excited for, because you're against Mickey Vago, of course, in the Vago in person. Favorite. Yeah, the Vago in person match, because, you know, you got to pay extra to see Mickey Vago wrestle now. He's a big podcaster. So the match happened, and right. So during the match, I was just enjoying it. In my own little world, and my wife Kelly turned to me and went, "Did he just swear?" And I turned around and went, "No, I didn't. I didn't hear this. I didn't hear it at all." And now that I've seen the video clip of it, I have no idea how I didn't hear it. But so we've got a couple of questions about it. We'll start off with Ryan Riley. One third of the Foundation of the Future. He's asked, "Hi Billy, if you would please." I always like that Ryan's very polite with his questions. Yeah. "Ask Ronan about his outburst at Summerhill Showdown and confirm if he can back up his claims."
I think I can back it up. I think, character wise, I think I'm pretty great. I mean, it was one of those things that. I've only really noticed it now, but it's something I just say like a lot in daily life. Like if I think something cool, I'll avoid saying it. I'll say that was amazing. So, it just kind of slipped out, and you can really see watching back. Like, I've tried to pull it back, but
I know I don't. So for those that are unaware, we won't put the clip in because, of course, WrestleZone's intellectual property. But if you can find it, it's at the end of the Mosh Pit episode of Summerhill Shenanigans, that caper of an episode. Of course, you flexed. You did the little gun show, and you went to Vago. That you're fucking amazing.
Yeah.
I'm amazing. Very quickly afterwards, and the crowd went ooh, and I went what? And so, yeah. So you've first match in Summerhill, and you've sworn in front of a crowd, which I think everyone's kind of I don't think wrestling crowds that bothered really when it comes to that, but they get a little. I think if it was Vago that did it, I think it would have been a little bit more because he's the good guy, but yeah, if you're heel doing it, I don't think they don't mind. Obviously, it's not going to be encouraged.
A lot of kids, but
yeah. So we've got Damien, of course, WrestleZone Undisputed Champion, who's also asked a question. He visited Twitter for first time in probably a year to ask this. How many more swears do you plan on doing?
Well, as of right now, none. No promises, but the swear actually really threw me off, I'll say, because I think. I don't know if you've seen about my match at Christmas Chaos, and I don't think you've seen the Trinity Academy one, but I'm a lot more vocal with the crowd in those matches than I was with Vago, because the second I said it, it kind of was completely to me like, oh, I can't trust myself to speak right now, so I'm just going to try shut up for the whole match, because we're saying it was such a like a oh no, I should have said that. You can see me kind of quickly go, okay, let's wrestle now, like let's get into this match.
So just for because you showed me beforehand, if you want to show your mask off to stop you swearing in the future, just for the video of yours,
I've got my little Dan Housing no swearing gimmick, just to try keep me right,
to remind you no swears in the future. But no, I mean if anything, I was gonna say it at least makes people remember you, even if it is
added to it.
The guy that swore.
It's the one thing that, it keeps the match in mind.
And of course, the big angle afterwards where you wedged Vago's wrist in the turnbuckle and kicked it as well. So not only were you getting the oohs and ahs for swearing, but you're also getting the vehement hatred because
just Mickey Vega.
Yeah, you destroyed the best podcaster in the Northeast, only because I'm in the North. say North, I'm in Murray. I think that's Northeast. But so it happened, and now that you've got to, at this point, of course, we're recording before the Ellen show, where you've got Sisto in your upcoming match, which I don't know if that's punishment for swearing, being in the ring with a Sisto. But you know, I like the system. It's ridiculous, but yeah, it's
a great gimmick. But
you go from Mickey Vago to Sisto. Hopefully, I'm not saying you should maybe break a Sisto's wrist, but you know, I wouldn't be against it. So this is kind of the awkward point of this kind of show where because I'm so far ahead with recordings, we're going to speak about. Like, you got your match with Sisto coming up in Ellen, which will be different. It's a bit more character based, and then
I'm quite excited.
I'm assuming you're going to be in the Regal Rumble, so we'll just for congratulations on winning. Congratulations, commiserations on losing.
Thank you.
Delete us going to
take that belt.
Yeah, I can't believe you won all the belts in one night and then the Regal Rumble at the end. It's ridiculous. It's insane. Yeah. So we'll go back. Yeah, exactly. We'll go back to the questions I've got, because we got some weird ones. We'll ramp them out because of your mates took over
the question feed.
So right, we've got Charlie Parker. I'm just gonna name all these. So we've got Charlie Parker. I like this question. I think it's a nice one. And he said, "Hi Bonin. I know literally." For anyone listening, that's what it says. Hi, Bonin. I know you're not too clever, so I'll ask an easy one. What's your favourite colour?
So, I can explain the whole, like, the name thing. My friends just think it's really funny to just spell my name wrong. They love it. Because one of my friends has this whole thing where he thinks it's really funny. If you say a two-letter word, you switch the first two letters and you just repeat it. So, of course, when I went up to him, I was like, oh, yeah, like, I'm going by Ronan King. He was like, oh, Conan Ring. And it's just taken off from then completely. Favorite color? I mean, honestly, gold, if that counts. Some people take it, some people don't.
That's your prospect in the future.
Seeing gold.
Yeah. So, got Omega Male, wonderful name. I'm sure it's his Christian name. How did you get such a fat ass?
Yeah, that was quite a good one. I don't really know how to answer that. Just a lot of hard work in the gym, I guess.
A lot of squats, apparently.
I do love a good squat. So
I mean, I earn my fat ass through eating. That's about all I've got.
It's a much more enjoyable way.
Absolutely. I will go to. Was it cartoons on the beach with the steak? I'll go there instead of doing squats any day.
Same.
We've got some nice questions, though. We've got ones that are actually wrestling, kind of wrestling related. We've got Finn Woods 23 on Instagram, through the Finstagram. There you go. There's that one for free, Finn.
There you go.
What's the best way Ronan keeps in shape? I segued that. It's almost segued.
I'm not gonna lie, I work very, very hard in the gym. I love the gym right now, especially because a lot of my mates, you know, we all play a lot of sports mainly. So it's one of those things where it's like today when we're all in school and we had 2.5 hours of no classes. So 4 of us went down to the gym and we got a good workout in and came back to school. And it's just one of those things like I go 6 days a week right now. It's just constantly like, I mean, I wouldn't say I don't have a diet by any means. Like, if I see something that I want to eat, I'll eat it. But it's trying to mainly watch what I eat. And if I can have something healthier that I'll enjoy, I'll have that more.
I mean, I suppose if you're working out 6 times a week, you're burning off quite quickly.
Because I'm trying to bulk up right now. So that's why it's getting quite hard now.
Have you kind of picked up tips from the likes of, I mean, because I know Caleb Valhalla, he bulked up and leaned out in a ridiculous length of time. Have you been like picking the brains of himself and some of the guys at Rest of Zone?
I've asked him a few times. I've asked Ryan a little bit as well. Me and Connor Malloy, we go to the gym quite a lot together. So yeah, just stuff like that.
Do you find that's your kind of like your? Because a lot of people have their ways of like their mental health that keep it mellowed and you kind of release of all your worries, I suppose. Mine's this is my as I say in most podcasts, this is my social time. I do social stuff for about an hour and a half, and I don't have to speak to anyone for a couple of days, except family, because that would be very weird if I left this room and just did not speak to my wife for the rest of the day. But yeah, did you find that after, especially after like when you had your swearing incident at Summerhill, the next day you went to the gym, you kind of went a little bit harder to kind of work off that anxiousness you had from swearing.
Definitely, like. Whenever I either feel like upset or I'll either just feel like I really want to go gym. I just want to look amazing. Like trying to look amazing by anarchy is the goal right now. But even if it just had like a rough day or something, I just go to the gym and just, you know, everything feels better after it, because it's just something that's fun and you feel good about yourself after it.
Yeah, I mean, like I say, each their own. If it helps you, then that is the most important thing. The last question I've got from the online Twitterverse and Facebook and what have you is from Joel David, which again, quite a nice question that's come through. He's put, who does Ronan King aspire to be like in the wrestling business?
So this is someone I've not mentioned to you yet, but my favorite wrestler right now, and I honestly think he's best in the world, and I no one else has said it, but I think he is. Just by quality of matches right now, Will Ospreay, 100%. I think he's just the boy. He's another level.
Are you trying to throw in a bit more high flying into your repertoire? Yeah. Then?
Well, you know, right now I've got some new moves hoping to do quite soon, but I'm still doing a lot of, especially right now he's quite strikey. So I've taken a few strikes and stuff. I want to throw in a lot more of the flippy stuff that you can do, you know, get an exciting few flips and athletic moves in, as well as hard hitting.
And of course, I'm going to guess, like, obviously AJ Styles for longevity and all that kind of stuff will be in like, there. Yeah.
If I can still go like he can at that age, then, oh man, that'd be insane. I don't think I'd be able to, but wow.
I know. What was he, mid-40s now or something like that? Is that something... Early 40s, like something
40,
insane.
Like 40, 44 maybe, I don't know. Something around there.
Something ridiculous. Yeah. And even this year, I was still like going, yeah, I'm wanting Styles to win the Rumble. I want him to be a main event in WrestleMania. And it's not like, he's too old to do it. And I think nowadays, anyway, I mean, I don't know how to kind of articulate this properly, but I think the longevity of wrestlers, maybe that's what's causing things like WWE to be a little bit staler, because these guys are so much healthier now at 44, near 50. John Cena's almost is tipping 50, just about anyway. So these guys are now so much healthier; they're there for longer. Because I mean, think about what Steve Austin's main event run was 3 years.
Yeah,
you wouldn't think that wouldn't cut it now. Nowadays, you have to have a good 10 years main event and no bother. Anyway, that's my soapbox. I'm just gonna get off it for a second. Someone can shout at me for saying I'm wrong. We've got two questions that we ask everyone. They're stupid questions. You may, if you listen to any past episode, you probably would have heard these questions. There's no right or wrong answer. What would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I'm going with the cow, to be honest. I feel like the sheep, you know, they follow each other. You know, they've not had too much brains. And like, I mean, if you've ever seen a cow kick, nobody wants to take that. So I've got the cow winning this one.
I've asked this question over 100 times now, and I still love that people put like any thought into it and just put a little bit of like logic. It blows my mind. The other one we ask is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, it's kind of boring, but I think a Velociraptor probably, I think, the coolest.
I get no wrong answers unless you pick like one of the dinosaurs from. I hate BJ from Barney, but again, this will be before.
Oh,
I don't know.
I know you.
I think actually, I'm getting a little bit of BJ. Hopefully, nobody clips this to make me sound like I'm saying anything disgusting. But I think it's because he had the cap and he had the big trainers and he was trying to look cool. I'm feeling a little bit of a crossover. Why I was like, I hate this guy when Ronan King came out. Somewhere else showed him going, I don't like the way he dresses. This isn't right. He's too young for me. He's too hip. He's too happy.
I'll just come out with a cap next time as well.
If you come out with a t-shirt going, I was about to say I love, and then I thought no, it can't be that because
you
can't do that after saying you're fucking amazing. You can't come out with a t-shirt saying I love that at the same time. That's too far. You've jumped the shark
backstage.
Yeah, you've jumped the shark at that point. So again, we'll swing back to the swing bit. Just again, just to round that off, what was the backstage reaction to it? Was it just a case of don't do that again kind of thing?
So, originally, nobody heard it, I don't think. I think very few people knew. Because the first thing I did when I went backstage was I went to one of the guys backstage and went, I'm so sorry about the swearing. And he just blew me off like it was nothing. I was like, does he know? Or is he just chill with it? So I kept walking. And then I remember Reese Dawkins on commentary texted me at halftime, just saying, fucking amazing. And I went, oh no, my heart sunk when I said that. He went, your mum's just come over and apologized. So she went over to Martin and all the commentators and was apologizing for my language. And then, it just got around. So it was more like, don't do it again, but like, you're still gonna get called fucking amazing after everything you do. So it's something I'll do like a role in training and just, I just get to, that was fucking amazing. And it's,
it's these things that come back around. It's like Brad Evans at the moment with the resurfacing of his feeling damn good about it promo for the Regal Rumble. These things.
They just keep going. They just keep going. You know what? You just build off it at least. Build off it.
There's probably ways you can merchandise it. Ronan effing King. There's things you can do. Get the old ECW t-shirt kind of style. ECFNW, Ronan effing King. There's
one I was thinking of, which you might be getting the behind the scenes exclusive of my first ever merch. But I was thinking Ronan King, and I was going to have a duck with the sunglasses on, maybe a bit of zebra print somewhere, and I just say like duck ing amazing or something. So you get the hint, but it's still PG.
Money. Absolute money. So at this point, again, like we were saying there, you got the match with Ellen coming up, so we can't really speak about it because it hasn't happened. I'm hoping to be at that show just because, why not? It seems like a really good card that's on there.
Yeah, it's a good card.
Regal Rumble's coming up. We've already discussed. You've won it. Excellent.
Yeah.
And then we're into Aberdeen Anarchy season. So as someone coming in quite late on, you will have been around for one or two, if that, Aberdeen Anarchies, and you're coming into this one now as a wrestler, whether you're on the pre-show, whether you're on the full show, we don't know. We'll find out closer to the time. But if you had to pick someone that you could be in the ring with, so wherever, Northern Hotel, that's where it is, Northern Hotel, one of WrestleZone's main homes, who would you want to, face Aberdeen Anarchy?
There's a few. Oh, like, obviously, I've barely got to touch the wrestling roster, so there's a lot I want to have matches with. Like, I'd love to have one with Damien, obviously. I'd love to have one with Conor Malloy. I'd love to have one with Dynamite, all those guys, Ryan Riley, Brad Evans. But me and Vago have unfinished business. I'd do that one more time. I'd like to go for Vago.
Get your teeth into a bit of a story and see how it goes. Yeah, that's the best thing about WrestleZone is that story aspect to it. Obviously it'll be for the title because you've won it all. So
So I'll have all the belts on the line.
Vago will have a chance to win all the belts, but we'll have to wait and see, but I can't wait to see it. So, like, the other last question we ask is kind of in the same vein, but it's you're getting booked in the biggest show of the year. I usually go WrestleMania, but as an AEW guy, All In, All Out, Shake All About, mm-hmm. I don't know what their big show is. But whatever the big show is, you get to pick your opponent, and it could be or opponents, any match type, who would it be? So fantasy book away.
Oh, okay. Give me a... Oh, that's a really tough one. Give me a fatal four-way steel cage between myself, AJ Styles, Kenny Omega, and Will Ospreay. I think that just screams money to me.
There you go. There's your main event to insert your biggest show here. Wrestle Kingdom. I don't know. Really, outside of the bubble, I'm a little bit lost. But no, this has been an absolute fascinating chat. Like I said, I always worry. I say this to guests that like are just new and about. I always worry when I've got someone like brand new that we don't have a lot to speak about, and we might like we get to about half an hour in, and I'm thinking, oh shit, I've got like an hour, at least half an hour. I want to get here. But no, I've had a lot of fun. I hope you have as well.
Definitely, yeah, 100%.
So before we wrap up, then where can people find out more about Ronan King on social media?
So on Instagram @Ronan_King_, same on Twitter, Facebook the Ronan King page, and the newly started Ronan King TikTok, which is the same as Instagram, @Ronan_King_. So that's where they all are.
Excellent. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
No worries. Anytime.